We are here at the Maxon booth at NAB 2019, showcasing cinema 4D, and we have a number of artists from around the world showing how they've used cinema within their workflows for clients, personal projects, games, medical, you name it, it's been used. Just a couple big pieces of information if you're just tuning in. Check out C4D Live. We're giving away over $25,000 of prizes, so you can jump on your phones right now, or if you're online, jump over to C4D Live, register. As long as you register between now and Thursday, you get your chance to win one of those prizes. Also, Redshift is now part of the Maxon family. Big announcement that happened at the start of the show. Also, we're nominated for Product of the Year here at NAB, and we got an Oscar for Mograph. So thank you to the community for all the amazing stuff you've done over the years. It's really inspired the community. Now we're getting recognized by Hollywood on a whole nother level. So thank you as artists. Really can't appreciate you guys enough. And I can't appreciate Brett enough for taking the time to come out. I know he has an incredible busy schedule over at Ranger and Fox. So let's give him a warm welcome. Brett Morris, Ranger and Fox.
Thank you. Thank you, Matthias. First of all, thank you to Matthias and Team Maxon for the invitation to come here to present. I always say yes to it because for me, 10 years plus I've been watching these presentations, and if it wasn't for the community that Maxon has built around these presentations, I certainly wouldn't be where I am today. So a lot of love for Maxon for making these available and accessible to everyone. And so yeah, anytime I get the opportunity to present, I always say yes because it's a little chance for me to give something back to the community. So thank you. My name is Brett Morris. I've got a little studio called Ranger and Fox. We're a 3D design animation studio based in Los Angeles, and we work primarily in brand, agency, and broadcast. We've just hit the 2-year mark for the company, and we had a chance to sort of step back, reevaluate our branding, and start to re-evolve our logo, our identity, and all of our materials in a way that spoke to the work. And so this was a really interesting process for us to go through because it was the first chance that we had to have something that represented the work as the work we intended to see. So we've built this dream studio. We've gone through the iterations of getting to this point, and having 2 years worth of work, we're actually able to present a showreel that I'm going to show you that I'm just super proud of. So please, enjoy. Thank you. So it's been a really interesting process for us over the last 2 years to basically start a company from scratch and have no work to show for it. And as we came from a background of, you know, doing these big 3D projects, each project that we've delivered, we tried to basically tell a story for clients to see the work that we're doing and entrust us to deliver something of the level that we're capable of doing. So over the last year and a half, up until this project came to us, we'd been building out our pipeline, we'd been building out all the infrastructure around us to handle a project of this scope. The client that came to us was a company called Naga that was based out of Germany, and they're a fintech company that offers a cryptocurrency. At the time, we had enough work that we were able to entertain a conversation with them, and after sort of walking them through our work, they were confident enough to roll the dice with us to entrust us with a project of this scope. So a little bit about Naga. They're a, like I said, a cryptocurrency company that offers this wider range of financial services and products under their ecosystem. And their flagship product, flagship film that they wanted us to make, needed to encapsulate all of the products and services that they offer in a way that was visually appealing and tells the story of this world that they're creating. So they have 15 different products and services, and they wanted to envision what each of these cities would look like in a 3D world. And think Game of Thrones, because it was certainly a big inspiration for this. They wanted to be able to fly through this world and introduce their audience to all of the services that they have. So it was a pretty big project. I mean, we were certainly pretty nervous about going into something of this scale, but in a pretty compressed timeline of about 10 weeks, we had to deliver a 90-second animation, which we'll check out in a second, a 30-second teaser, and a 5K map. So conceptually, the company offers this cryptocurrency called the Naga coin, and it is the lifeblood that powers up all of their products and services. Each one of their products and services relies on the coin in some way. So as we're going into the concept and we're trying to figure out what this project looks like, we're trying to think of these visual anchors that we can start to build a sequence around. So our baseline objective was to try and make a futuristic and optimistic world. We needed to make it feel epic and cinematic, but also approachable. So the central idea was to try and build out this incredibly large world and let this presence of red power up all of these cities. I mentioned that we had 10 weeks to execute this project, and it was just an incredibly large project for us to handle. We had to design, develop, model, rigged and animated, look dev for 15 cities on top of this 90 seconds of animation. This slide gives you a nice before and after of our development to delivery. This image on the right is the final delivery, which was the 5K map. And what we're looking at here on the left is an initial sketch that we put together in the first couple of days of the project. So we had some level of ideas, seeds that we could build each of these cities around. I mean, we obviously knew what the service it was, and with that we had a general thread that we could sort of start to have a conversation around what that should be and how it would look in the context of this world. I mentioned that the coin was going to be the center and the lifeblood of the world, and that's represented by this gem solar tower, which is surrounded by a bunch of solar panels that in real life something like that would just absorb all the solar rays and then store the energy and broadcast it out. So our initial idea was, hey, let's have this in the center of the world. It's just broadcasting red energy, and each one of the islands that hold all of the cities will just sort of activate and respond to this energy. As things change, as things evolve with the business objectives, we ended up changing for a totally different process throughout the initial stage, where we ended up reconfiguring the layout of the land to give more of a top-down approach. So we have the coin that sits up the top, and down the bottom we've got the subway system, which was the wallet. And the idea of putting the wallet down the bottom was it's a transparent glass safe, which if you know about cryptocurrencies, there's a lot of transparency. So the safe sits down the bottom, and then this subway system runs underneath the world and connects all of the cities together. So for us, we were trying to dive into the vernacular of the business. We're trying to establish a syntax around it. So as we're presenting ideas to the client, they understand that we're fully bought into their product, and we're able to walk in lockstep with them as we're sort of uncovering what these creative decisions would be. And I think for anyone that gets into a big project like this, the quicker you can buy into the language and the quicker you can buy into the company, the easier it is to have sell through, because I think there's a little bit more confidence in that process. So this is the city that we're going to see from the beginning all the way through the end of this project. This is what we called the virtual city. And outside of the wallet, which is the product that stores the actual currency, the virtual is sort of like a treasure chest that holds any of any assets that have been bought, purchased or sold online. So if you think about gaming, you might purchase a skin or a character or something like that. This is the place that that asset would live. So in the early stages, we're thinking, okay, well, it's gaming focused. It's obviously futuristic. We need some device that holds some level of an icon or an asset. Maybe we can think hologram, and hey, whatever this hologram is it in a box? What's powering the box? So we're trying to discover what these cities should look like. So at that early stage, we're just gathering references. We just want to get references in front of the client so we can say, hey, does this speak to the product? Does this answer the business objectives of the product? And are we heading on the right direction? So we use references to really expedite that conversation. And we worked with a storyboard artist that helped us sort of visualize some of these ideas really quickly. And even a crude sketch like that, to get that in front of the client, they get super excited because they're starting to see what their cities look like. And it gives us some level of confidence that we can move forward into the next stage of production. Down the bottom, we've got a finished production style frame. And after we end on this storyboard, we go through design, modeling. You can see that there's a lot of design assets in this style frame. We've got the city. We've got this transparent box, which has got the holograms that I mentioned. And everything's being powered by these elongated capsules that are sitting at the base of it. And throughout this project, we had tons of pop culture references. Obviously, we've got Ghost in the Shell, but these elongated capsules were from Minority Report. So if anyone remembers that scene, there's these sort of like floating waves. And so we connected with the client really quickly in a really meaningful way when we were sort of talking about these pop culture references. So any chance we had, we'd always say, hey, there's a Fight Club sequence where the camera moves around really sporadically, but it's really focused. Can we use that sort of camera language as we're developing the sequence? And the client loved that. You know, anytime they could see and visualize exactly what we were talking about, as soon as they could see how it was applied to their product and this sequence, they bought in straight away. And for such a large project, there was a lot of stuff to get approved before we could get to the finishing line. And it was just, We didn't have a lot of time, so we just used any strategy we possibly could to get this done as quickly as we could. And this is the final video that we made for him.
Welcome to a new world where finance, gaming, and cryptocurrencies come together like never before. An ecosystem of interconnected services that put the tools to succeed in your hands. The Naga universe is a dynamic landscape. Where you can create an investment portfolio. Effortlessly exchange Bitcoin and cash. Buy and sell in-game items. And learn how to trade and invest like a pro. All via cutting-edge technology that is smart, secure, and easy to use. The paradigm has shifted. The road to exciting new opportunities is clear. Naga is the future, and it's already here. Naga, turn your passion into wealth.
Thank you. So I mentioned that we're a pretty small team. It's Steve, my business partner, and executive producer, Monica Ramon. But we scaled up for this project. There was no way that just two people were going to be able to do this. So I want to give a massive shout out to Rich Nosworthy, Patrick Goski, Blake Foley, and Oscar Maher. These four fine gentlemen lent their time to this project, and each one of them brought such a specialized skill set that we were able to tap into and just get so much incredible work out of them. And my boy, Blake Foley, just released his first showreel in like 10 years today. So yeah, please check it out. It's blakefoley.com, and the guy is an absolute beast. I want to sort of talk holistically about how we approach a project like this. We obviously had a pretty constrained timeline that we had a huge amount of work to get through, and we just needed to be the most efficient and effective artist that we possibly could be to enable us to be able to deliver a project of this size. So we have a low poly workflow for something like this in the early stages. So for context, each of the 15 cities would be developed in their own individual scene file. Everything's done at world zero, and we have a general idea of what the layout and scale of the world is going to be. So as everyone's kind of working on an individual city, trying to develop it and, you know, ideate through the process, we're sort of building everything out, getting in front of the client, and a city like this, which is virtual, this is our sort of finished scene, and the elongated capsules that we have down the bottom, they're turned off for this because there was just so much density to those polygons that we had to take shortcuts here and there, and just by turning things off enable us to kind of move quickly. However, at this time as this city's being developed, we need something that we can take into an animatic scene file so we can actually understand what the design of the sequence is going to look like. So if we take that high density model into the production file to build out the cameras, our playback is slower, we are not getting the right sort of feel when we're moving around the scene. So at the end of every milestone, we'd basically just commit to a low poly version of what that city would look like, and then we'd take it into a scene and use that low poly version to sort of mold our cameras. And let's jump over to cinema to see what this world looks like. So kind of ugly at this stage. There's obviously no detail level. There's no surrounding buildings. Every city is just reduced down to a handful of boxes or just basic shapes just to give the essence of what that city is. We know exactly what this is going to look like, and we would have been doing style frames to parallel these. So at least when the client does see this, they know, hey, when this is finished, it's going to look like this, but they can at least feel comfortable seeing everything in context as we're working through the sequence. We'd have each of our cities in here, and you can see 1 through to 15. These would have just been brought in from that working file and just placed around the scene. At the early stages of the project, I showed you that we had one layout, which is what the coin was sitting in the middle, and the surrounding cities in a circle formation. As things changed with the project, as it was evolving, we needed to work in a pretty efficient way that allowed us to make quick changes on the fly and know that we weren't sort of disrupting any sort of progress that we were making with the individual cities. So this low-poly workflow just allows us to get into the scene, see everything in context, move things around in a very non-destructive way. It's also the scene that we're actually building our cameras with. So we've got a little camera rig that we like to use at this stage of the project, and we just call this our camera rig. And this is just it's basically just a null that retains a lot of information, and it populates across cinema the information that we want to see here. So we just have the ability to change the shot name, and in this instance, we're just looking at S4 for shot 4. If we change that to something else, like shot 4, it's going to change up in the name in the null, and that's just going to be something that we're able to see pretty easily when we just look at the null. We've got a status whether or not the camera is good or if it needs revisions. So we're always trying to make things visible to the viewport and object manager, so at least we know how far things have moved along without having to sort of talk to someone else. So we're always building these little things into our scenes that just make the conversations around progress as efficient as it can be. We've got a camera link, which is linking to the camera that needs to be rendered. And in this case, it's just the last one in the list. And we know that it's the render camera because it's been added into that slot. And we do that so when we're over here in the takes, we can just look through this huge list of takes, and we know when we come down to our camera shot 4 render, that's the camera that we want to be activated in our take. So again, it's just these little things that allow us to just automate and systemize our process as we're trying to move through iterations as quickly as possible. We've got some render settings, we've got the phase, whether or not we want to be in hardware, cinema, or redshift, frame rate, and start and end. So we're going through these cameras, we're just rendering, we're loading it up in Premiere, and we're just watching the sequence. We try and make sure that there's one-to-one parity with the frames between 3D and our editorial, so we know that we're building out our scene in a very linear fashion. And so this sort of workflow just allows us to just burn through cameras as quickly as possible, and we're really not being held back by anything slowing us down or anything like that. So let's jump back into PowerPoint, and let's check out what the sequence looks like when we're at this point.
Welcome to a new world where finance, gaming, and cryptocurrencies come together like never before. An ecosystem of interconnected services that put the tools to succeed in your hands. The Naga universe is a dynamic and exciting landscape where you can create an investment portfolio, effortlessly exchange Bitcoin and fiat currencies, buy and sell in-game items, and learn how to trade and build wealth. All via cutting-edge tech that is safe, secure, and easy to use. The paradigm has shifted. The road to financial freedom is clear. Naga is the future, and it's already here. Naga, turning your passion into wealth.
So obviously pretty crude at this point, but we've solved most of the foundational issues that we're going to come against with the client in this process. We've looked at the editorial, we've looked at the pacing, we've synced it up with music, we've got VO in there, and putting something like that in front of the client as early as possible just gives everyone that level of confidence that we can move into the next stage with, you know, absolute certainty that this thing's going to work, because we certainly don't know until we see it at that level. I want to go back into cinema for a second and just show you something that was something to solve early on, but we didn't exactly know how to handle this. So if I jump out of this camera, you may have noticed that we're sort of sitting on these tiles, which are numbered. So as each shot was developed and we were looking at the sequence, we're adjusting things subtly. We're saying, hey, if we're down here for this shot, we're looking at the trader building, we want to make sure that we can have some level of context of what the surrounding settings are. But as we're moving the camera from one area to another, we need to figure out what that spatial distance is between the clusters of cities, because if we're too far away from the cities, we need more time to get the camera from A to B, or if we have to do it in a certain amount of time, that camera feels way too light and it's way too quick. If the buildings are too close to each other, then everything feels really compact. So we were trying to strike up this balance of making everything feel large and epic, but also, you know, compact and, you know, felt like a comfortable level that we could fly around. You'd have a level of context of where the proximity to the cities were to each other, and we were actually able to use that to our benefit as we're thinking about compositions. So the city space was expanding and contracting with every pass as we were sort of answering those questions. But every time we did it, we always had this grid that would sit over everything. And this was a way for us to basically measure the size of the world. And we were going to use this bit of information to generate our geometry. And I want to transition into the next stage by just letting you know that this sort of thinking early on just sets you up for success. We'll stress test and analyze every point of the production verbally and then start to refine and explore different solutions that we can stress test early on, so we know once we get into crunch mode and time is really against us, we've got the right systems in place that we can actually move forward efficiently, and also at the same time compress all of those troubles into a small compact timeline to allow us the most amount of time to be creative as we're like discovering what each of the 15 cities are and lighting and shading and you know, the real fun stuff in 3D. Okay, so that's when we want to talk about the buildings and the land that we're going to shift into next. So we had a solution that we were sort of exploring early on to solve this issue of geometry generation for this world. The tiles were set up in a way that allowed us to think of the space and the world that we were in, but also how to translate the information that we were seeing in the world to a solution that would generate geometry for us as easy as possible. So we had a sort of one-to-one parody of what we were seeing in cinema in Photoshop, and you can see everything's just 1 through to 16 as we would see it. And anytime any of the city the cities would move or we had any iteration of the formation, we would simply just render out a top-down occlusion pass like this, just from a top camera from cinema, and we would know for sure that this is exactly where everything is living in this world. So we probably went through maybe a dozen iterations of different formations, because every time we would do a basic sequence, show it to the client, they'd like it, but hey, maybe there's a business objective where we'd have to take one cluster of cities and move it closer or farther away from another set based on how the ecosystem of their products actually behaves with each other. There was some issues that we had for legal as far as like the credit card not sitting too close to certain areas. So we had to be really flexible. And because we knew that we needed to be flexible early on, we just wanted to make sure we had a system that was ready to go. And at any point, we could basically pull a trigger and generate the entire world in a really quick and efficient way. And we did that just by sketching something out in Photoshop. And this bitmap would be brought back into Cinema to make sure that we had parity between Cinema and Photoshop. And once we were pretty happy with the general layout of these bitmaps, we'd end up with something like this. Now, this is just to indicate where the land formation is going to be. So if when we see the final video at the end, but if you remember to what you've just seen, each of these islands is sort of just floating. There is an under floor that's sitting below everything, but we needed sort of an elevated platform for these cities to sit on because we had a subway system that was running through everything. So we wanted transparency into the under the world, which you'll see throughout this spot. So this was a way for us to be able to be pretty strategic as far as where these platforms were that were going to hold the cities. We would then export out each tile as an individual bitmap. So this is tile 1, 2, 3, and I'll just go back so you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this was just the top line over there. We would export these out and then run them into Houdini. So Houdini is a great tool. I'm definitely not a Houdini artist. I've been trying to learn it for some time, but I'm basically good enough to talk to a Houdini artist, and that's about it. So for me, I was just jerry-rigging a bunch of tutorials and scripts and stuff to basically build this little thing that would take the bitmap and generate geometry based on what we were feeding into it. And the way this system worked would be if the pixel was white, there'd be no subdivision, so you'd see a couple that are quite large, and then the darker the value was, we'd increase the subdivisions to the point where if it was black, we would just do a delete node that would just kill those small polygons, and that's what gave us our coastline. But as you see, as you get close to the coastline, the subdivisions are compacting on top of each other. There's like a little bit of an extrude thing going on, so the larger ones are a little bit deeper, and the smaller ones are quite small. There's a little bit of Y variation in it, so the platform itself is not perfectly smooth. And that was one component that we would create from the Photoshop to Houdini exchange. The second one is based on exactly the same mat, but it was just simply white and black. And this one was generating just a simple area that had certain subdivisions in it, which represented the exact landmass that we had. And the reason why these are all uniform is because this is going to be our source geo that all the buildings are going to apply themselves to. So this is the sort of thinking that we had very, very early on. We needed a system and a solution that said, hey, no matter how these cities move and undulate and keep iterating, we can have a system that would take us from a complete change all the way through to generating the geometry, plugging into Cinema in about 30 to 45 minutes. There was obviously a lot of mouse clicks to go through all of the bitmaps, but at least this way we had a system that would protect us from any changes that we were going to face throughout. The tile formation that we had was also to protect us from if we had a certain camera move that wasn't even going to see half of the map, we could just turn half the map up. So we were always looking for ways to reduce any sort of extra processing through every step of the way, but making sure that we were never overdoing the work, the time, or just the rendering and the processing to handle the information that we needed. Because as you saw in the spot, there's a couple of shots that you see thousands of buildings in it. So I'll jump over to Cinema again and talk about what this actual building system looked like. So this is just a basic cloner. We've got our geometry in it, and each one of these children, clones, represent a different clone. So Rich Nosworthy modeled these, and our sort of general direction for these was to try and look at modern architecture in Japan as well as Abu Dhabi and take a little bit of Sidmead and just try and make a hybrid combination of the three of them. And as I increase this, we're just simply in iteration mode, so we're just seeing the next clone in the count. And as we get beyond 34, we reset and then start seeing the next series of clones come in. So this is all really good just to see that succession of the building. And the ordering is really important because we want to have the first clone of that stack to be the smallest, and we want the last one to be the highest. And we do that because we have the ability to actually use fall-off effectors to control which areas are going to be the higher buildings versus the smaller ones, and that's through the sorting method. So if we change this over to sort, we just reset what we're looking at. We're seeing it the first cloner, and we can just prove that by turning on and off the geo, and we know for sure that this is the building that we're looking at. So to add the level of control to sort through those, we need a plane effector, and this is working because everything jumped up. I'm going to change our falloff over to linear, and I'll switch this over to negative X. And as I run this through, you can see that we're dropping these down. So I want to remove this position value. And to change the buildings that we're going to see, we want to modify the clone. So as I increase this, you can see that we're cycling through the different clones in our series of buildings. And what's happening is, as I've stopped at the 50% mark, the 50% value is being plugged into the cloner, and it's searching through this stack, and it's finding the clone that is closest to the 50% value, and it's now showing that through the cloned instance. And if I increase this all the way up to 100, you can see that we go straight to our highest building. If we just increase the falloff and play around with the falloff strength, you can see now we've just got this falloff effector that we can move around and pretty freely just determine which buildings are going to be seen. And this is at its core what we were using to basically art direct and design this world. And so all of these little steps that we were taking enabled us to be fluid, flexible, and no matter how things changed, there was never any like sweat on us. We knew we had a really robust system, and going into a big project like that just gave us all the confidence that we were going to be fine on the other end. So I'm going to jump into this next scene, which is just transitioning over. We've got this... Sorry, let me just turn this off. We've got basically the same setup as we were looking at just now, except we've cloned the buildings onto this bit of geo. So we've got the cloners set up as an object mode, and it's simply just cloning onto the polygon center. We're in sort mode, which is what we were just looking at, and we can now look at our effectors list, and our effectors list has a couple of group falloffs. We've got off, random, there's a random color, a sort, and a position Y. Each one of these group effectors is doing something really specific, and the order of operations is really important to make sure that we're not overlapping any of the data as we go through this. So I want to just check out our effectors list, our effectors, and close these up and just focus on sort. So I want to use this moment to identify that this project was done in R18. So it was done in Q3 of last year, just as R20 was coming out. We held off from upgrading as we were in production, and we handled this part of the process in the way that I'm going to show you, but know that this is easily applied to fields. So instead of doing a group effector and adding extra effectors inside of that group, in which you'll see in a second, you would simply just have one falloff effector using this parameter of whatever it's going to do and just keep adding fields to spread and duplicate out. So it's very similar, and no, it's very applicable to R20. So if we turn the group sort on, you can see that we've just got two effectors, a random weight and a virtual, If we turn the virtual on, you can see that we've now switched over to some of our higher buildings. And you can see that just moving this around, it's really easy to see where the higher buildings are going to be. You can see that it's a pretty distinct fall-off as the fall-off moves through it. And when we add the random weight before it, we can increase the weight strength to some of the weights to have a different, an irregular effect for that fall-off. So as we move it around, you know, you're sort of breaking up the edge. So any extra layer of data that we can put onto things just really helps us break up those even lines. So we'll move up to the top of the list now and sort of work our way back down. But I wanted to show the sort first, just coming out of that last scene. So if we turn the group off, nothing happens. So if we turn on the children, we've got this random off buildings effector. So this is just a simple threshold random effector that is just turning off a certain amount of buildings. It's completely random, and I have the ability to increase or decrease the strength of this based on the minimum max. And you can see that if we wanted a much more sparse area of buildings, we would just increase or decrease that value. The plane off virtual is simply just a slab turned off. Now, this is a just a box fall off. And the reason why it looks like this is because I've actually got our low poly virtual low city in here. And this is how we basically controlled where the buildings were going to be generated. And using fall offs in this way, it didn't matter that if we had built out this entire world, we had populated everything, we'd gone through this process. Even if the client was like, hey, I really like this camera move, but I just can't live with where that building is right now. Can we just move it over here? You know, maybe we'd kick up a bit of a song and dance saying it's really hard, but really, in reality, we just move this fall off over and we're fine. And that would go for the sorts as well. So we were always understanding that this was a fluid process, and we wanted to make sure that we were adaptable at every point of the process. Next, I want to find an area that has... might just move this over here. So if we look at these buildings here, these are all the highest buildings that we've got, but they're all pretty uniform. There's no rotational information on these. So what we've got below here is our group random, which is handling all of our additional random rotation as well as a bit of Y randomization. So this this group, if I turn the first effector on, it's a shader effector. I've got a noise shader in here. There's only contrast, so it's white and black and nothing in between. And so that having that shader effector basically says you're either going to just stay as you are or you're going to take on this value. And the parameter is 180 degrees, so when I hit this, we'll see some of these rotate 180 degrees. Subsequently, the next one down is a 90, and again, it is just a duplication. All I've done is change the seed, and I'm just stacking these shader effectors on top of each other, and the last one is a negative 90, so at this point, all of these clones have the ability to be 0, 90, 180, or 270 degrees based on this little system. You could do this with the formula effector with a little bit of code, but I like the idea of controlling it with the shader effector just for the simplicity of just saying, hey, I've got a shader, I can control the scale and spread of the shader and the style of noise that I wanted to put in there as well. And lastly, there's just a Y position that would just add a little bit of Y random. So even though we know these are all the same buildings, just this group of effectors just separates everything out enough that it just breaks up the pattern, and we know that, hey, there's some level of a systematic approach to add that random to everything. At a certain point throughout production, we found that the client started asking us, hey, is it possible to have all of these buildings rise up with the shots? We're talking about this world coming to life. Wouldn't it be really cool if, you know, all the buildings are rising up? And again, having this system, working with effectors, you can just add on another plane effector into the stack and everything should behave as intended. So that's exactly what this position Y is. And when we play this back, You can see that we've just got a little bit of wire rotation. There's some randomness to it, so we're not getting an even rise of all the buildings. And that's just by adding a little bit of random weight before the position. So I'll just pull out for a second. And the last thing that we had was the Mograph color. So we were using color, not visually, but to drive some redshift shaders. I'll go into these in a second, but just know that we're handling color. So before we sort of move on into the shading stuff, I want to show what this system looked like at a glance of how easy it was to work with. So in our geostatic, we've got this source geo and we've got our cloner. So if I'm to duplicate this by just holding command, make a duplication, move this over, you can see that we've got the same parameters in the buildings that we've been looking at. Some are randomizing themselves to turn off. There's a little bit of Y rotation, but nothing's really being affected with that sort, nor the block that we were looking at. We can keep duplicating these systems over and over again, and making sure we have that parent selected. We can duplicate these systems over and over again. And once we get a nice little extension of that first platform, you can see as there's overlap of the other effectors, we're still taking on those parameters. So in a world in which there's some decisions to move this city over here, we would simply just run all the geometry through our Photoshop to Houdini system. We would then zero out the geometry on each of the tile. The fall-offs were totally independent of all of those changes. So if we loaded everything up, went through the process of getting the geometry back in here, we might see something like this. And just how I was showing you before, it was just so easy for us to move things around. And if we would just maybe look from the top view, move this effector down, we would just frame things up to be nice and snug for this for the city. And any adjustments that we needed to make was just, it was almost real time for us to do this. And likewise with this. So if there was another city in this world, we would just, let's just place it over here. Say this is overlapping two of these tiles. If there was another city in here and we needed to just increase some complexity with the effectors that we had, it's very easy for us just to duplicate our off. So we want this new effector to turn off all these buildings where this city is sitting here. And because this group effector is added to every single one of these clones, instead of adding that new effector to every single one of these clones, we're doing it via the group effector. So that group effector is basically our filter point for all of the information to go through it, and then it populates and spreads across all of the cloners that have that group effector. So we can obviously do this with fields now. It makes life a lot easier. If you are to use groups, obviously you can do some interesting things like this. So again, super easy. It was very, very flexible for us to work this way. And if I'm to increase the building heights around this new city, I would just add this to the sort and start moving our effector in place to rise those buildings up around it. So with every adjustment, we would go through all of the compositions, make sure that the spread of the buildings was looking fine, depending on what the shot was, depending on what we were going for. Sometimes we'd need a lot of high buildings, sometimes a low buildings, because we were always looking composition and making sure that we had some level of context of where the coin was sitting. So there's these really large beams that are blasting out of the coin, and we wanted to make sure that we were always giving a line of sight back to the coin. So you'll see there's like all of these little composition details that we're always trying to give context for where everything was at every step of the way. So going back over to our presentation. So beyond that system, we would have a couple of extra steps to see through before we actually got into rendering. Once we had a system like this where we had all of our geometry and we had all of our effectors and everything set up, we would then convert everything to Redshift proxy. So obviously the huge news for this week is Redshift joining the Maxon family. And for a small studio like ours that relies on Redshift, we couldn't be happier with the news. So all of our workflows and techniques that we've been building since day one of Redshift coming on board, we are just thrilled that this is, a partnership that we're feeling like we made the right decision to join Redshift. So once we're in proxy mode, we still have access to that Mograph color that we were looking at. So that, random color. So the random color, it's quite hard to see here, but each one of the matrices for the clones has a slightly color offset color from each other. And we had this shader system that was basically taking our color information and doing two things with it. One, it would split the color value off into a value that allowed us to basically randomly choose a different texture to load in, and at the same time, it would also choose a random color from a gradient that we had made. And then it would basically take that random color, random texture, join it together. And with that, we're able to give every single one of these buildings a unique texture and color combination. And we're also offsetting the UVs. So there was a little bit of shifting in the positions as well. So with all of these layers of randomization stacked up on top of each other, we're able to get to a point like this pretty easily with, you know, minimal clicks. And it was all about just being creative and making sure that we were doing the best for the sequence and letting all the right tools do their job in this process. We also baked in a 3D gradient into all of the buildings, and this was never seen in the beauty pass, but we have this stored in the AOV, so when we were rendering out, we always had access to a bit of a Y gradient for all the buildings in case we wanted to sort of boost the values as they got close to the ground. Once we take it through this whole system, we would run it through Deadline. And Deadline is an incredibly helpful tool, but sometimes things don't always behave the way they need to be. So just making sure our proxies are behaving on the farm, making sure the texts are loading up. Once we get a render test like this, we feel really happy about where we're at. And before I jump too far, this is a... somewhat of a production file. I've kept all of the low polygon cities in here just to keep things light for the presentation. But this is ultimately what our real production file looked like. We'd have our land segments from 1 through to 16. And we've still got the same world scale. We've still got the same placements as all of these cities. And even still, like, we would take the low polygon versions right to the nth degree before switching them over to the high res when we were actually ready to get into lighting and shading. It just makes everything so much lighter, and we were never putting any bottlenecks in the pipeline. So if I look at any of these, and we're looking at 6 at the moment, I'll just turn on our cloner, and we're just turning on that stack of buildings around it. And then if I jump into our cameras, we can start to see exactly what this shot looked like. I think it's this one. And we're still able to move through the scene pretty quickly, even though we've got all of these buildings turned on. So the proxies themselves allow us to throw even more geometry into the scene than what Cinema could handle. And Redshift takes over at that point and loads all the meshes in. The combination of everything, we were always just trying to be mindful of how much pressure we were putting in ourselves and on the system. So... what I've shown is just a small slice of what went into making this video. I wanted to be able to present some of the core ideas that we had at the beginning of the project that we wanted to set ourselves up for success. And we knew some of these like really heavy lifting portions of the project, we wanted to make them as lightweight as possible. So each one of these cities, so much love and detail went into them to make them come alive. This breakdown video gives you a little bit more context of some of the storyboarding process, the design elements, and some of the R&D that went into them. And so hopefully with a combination of everything, it gives you a good insight into how this project came together.
We'll be right back.
Thank you. So, you know, I said at the beginning that, you know, I've been fortunate to be able to do this for the last couple of years, and watching these presentations over the years has just been tremendously helpful for my growth and development as an artist. And I think it's a testament to Maxon putting these on for the community to benefit from, and I think that's really encouraged a lot of transparency and sharing of how we work. And so with these learnings that I've had from over the years from all of these other artists, I've formulated my own way of working. And when a project like this comes along, I feel confident that I've got the right tools to be able to execute at the level that I want to. So in closing, let's check it out one more last time. And hopefully you've got enough context for exactly what went into this.